friends, it is so good to be with you all today. And I'm going to share with you a story. A story about the church. Because really the story of the church is a story about, it's a love story between God and God's people. And this love story begins at the very beginning with all that is. And at the beginning, the all that is was all there was. And the all that is was pure light and love. And yet the all that is as pure light and love couldn't experience itself as that, because that was all that existed. It was like that dilemma. You ever heard that God is like a rose that created a nose to smell itself? And so, boom, out of nothing came all things in creation. And it was this magnificent display, and all things were created, and after each thing was created, God said, this is good, and this is good, and this is very good. And so it was this magnificent potential to experience ourselves as love and light. But God knew once all of creation was manifested that there was also this potential, because of free will, for a lot of pain and a lot of suffering. Once people used that freedom in different directions that were harmful. And so the all that is had this great idea. It said, in order for people not to forget, I'm going to put something inside each of them. It's like this divine homing chip, this divine blueprint inside everybody so that they don't forget. And all they have to do is to go within to remember that that always exists. And nothing that ever happens circumstantially in anyone's life will ever take that away. It's like if God is the ocean, then each of us are souls, waves on that ocean. And nothing can ever take that away. And so that is who and what we are. And God trusted that when we forgot that we would look within to remember that. And things started out okay with humans, but after a little while, people started to forget. And eventually there was conflict, and then there was disease and poverty and war and violence. And so people continued to forget and forget who they were and forget that divine inner light that was inside of them. And so God had this idea to say, you know, people aren't remembering to go inside to remember that. And so I'm going to give them some external guidance. And so in a particular time and place, a man named Moses was born. And Moses was particularly in tune to that divine inner voice. And so Moses listened to that divine voice giving some external commandments. And this worked for a time, but eventually it started to get complicated because there were lots of rules and laws, over 600 of them. And so soon, the people started to get kind of confused, and a whole class of people called the priests began to come into existence because they had to specialize in the laws. And soon those priests began to think that they were superior and better than the people because they knew the law better than everybody else and they practiced the law better than everybody else. And so soon things started to get distorted and the people continued to forget who they were. And so the divine presence realized that people were continuing to forget who they were. And so over the centuries, God continued to send prophets to the people and judges to remind them who they were. And send prophets like Jeremiah, who told the people that God didn't want the law written on tablets of stone, but on human heart. And prophets like King David, who remind the people where to look. He said, be still and know that I am God. And prophets like Micah, who, you know, when the people said, what does God require of us? Is it thousands of sacrifices and we should go to the temple and sacrifice thousands of times? And Micah said, nope. God requires just three things: to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with God. And yet the people continued to forget. They forgot to look within. They forgot who they were. They forgot whose they were. They forgot what they were about. And they continued to oppress the widow and the orphan and the stranger among them. And so God had this quandary. What am I going to do? And then the all that is had this brilliant idea. It was, oh, could only come from the mind of the all that is. Said, you know what? I'm going to send them myself. Because if I send them myself, oh, then they'll know who I am and who they are. And then it'll be very clear to them to remember who they are and that they are this spark of light that's always within them. Nothing can do anything about it. Man, what a great idea. And so into another particular time and place, a man named Jesus was born in a town called Nazareth. And this man named Jesus, man, he came and he said, turn from the dark side. That's another plot. But he said, repent and believe in the good news. And he reminded the people who they were. He said, you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. So don't hide your light under a bushel basket. Don't lose your saltiness. Because then what are you good for? What is salt good for if it's lost its saltiness? What is the lamp good for if it's hidden under a bushel basket? So remember who you are, and remember that the kingdom of God is within you. To go within, to remember that that's where the kingdom of God was. And this Jesus not only talked about love and service and forgiveness, but fully lived them. Fully lived those things out. And yet there was a problem with Jesus because the people in religious and political authority felt threatened by Jesus. And they were confused by Jesus. They didn't understand why he would appeal to the masses. Because his message was way too simple. But they had all these laws built up and around this complex institution. And when they asked Jesus, what's the most important law of all? He said, just love. Love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. And he said, in that is all the law and all the prophets. That's it. And so they found that love was too threatening. And so the people in political and religious authority decided that they needed to get rid of Jesus. And so they crucified him and put him to death. And so you can imagine that the disciples were distraught. They didn't know what to do until the third day came and Jesus appeared to them. And it was then that they realized that God was with them and had always been with them and would always be with them. And so that passion, that fire, informed the first century or two of the early church, and they were on fire for God's love and the good news of Jesus. And they put their lives in danger. They were martyred left and right, like people like Stephen, because they cared and were so passionate about their faith. But then what happened a couple centuries after Jesus was that Christianity became the religion of the empire. And so religion began to become more about the laws and the rules and about expectations and dogma and doctrine again. And it began about going to Mass and fulfilling all these things that we were expected to do. And you had to do all these things to earn God's love, like whether get indulgences. And so they forgot that this love was unconditional. It resided within all of them. And so the people continued to move farther and farther away from that divine birthright. And so God continued to send more and more prophets over the centuries. Prophets like Francis and Claire of Assisi, prophets like Teresa of Avila, like Martin Luther King Jr. and Dorothy Day, to remind the people essentially two things. One, that they are love and light, that exists within them. All they have to do is to go within to remember that, to be still and know that I am God. And the second, once they've received that love, then to go and make that love real in the world. To not stop at receiving the love, but to go and give it away and to make it real in whatever form that takes. And yet the people continued to forget and forget. But by doing so, we become co-creators with God and the unfolding of love and light in the universe. And so what a lot of church and religious scholars are saying today as they look at the course of church history is that there's this trend that has developed. And this trend is that about every 500 years or so, the church has to have what they call a rummage sale. And Anglican Bishop Mark Dyer says he's quoted in Phyllis Tickle's book, The Great Emergence, he says that the empowered structures of Christianity about every 500 years or so become whatever they may be at the time, become an intolerable carapace, like a hard shell, that has to be shattered in order that renewal and new growth may occur. I'll repeat that again. He says the empowered structures of institutionalized Christianity, whatever they may be at the time, become an intolerable carapace that must be shattered in order that renewal and new growth may occur. And according to Tickle and Dyer and many other church and religious scholars, we are going through one of those 500-year shifts right now. And because we're going through right now, we don't know exactly how it's going to play out. But we are living in a time where the majority of young adults outside of the church think that Christians are hypocritical, judgmental, anti-gay, and out of touch with reality. We're living in a time where, for a progressive mainline church, churches are closing and declining and dying left and right. So we're going through this major shift. We're going through what Matthew Fox calls a new reformation, what the new UCC minister and president, John Doerhower, calls Church 3.0. Now, John Doerhower calls, he admits it's a vastly oversimplistic model, but he says that out of the Reformation 500 years ago, he calls that Church 2.0 that developed. And now he says 500 years later, this new church is being born, which he calls Church 3.0. And because it's really not all that different. It's actually pretty similar to Church 1.0 and Church 2.0. It still has love and it still has faith at the center of it. It just takes on different forms and different expressions. And because we're in the middle of it, we don't know exactly how it's going to manifest. One of my church planting mentors says that, you know, if we were to wake up tomorrow and the year was 1950, most of our churches would be prepared for vital ministry. But chances are we're going to wake up tomorrow and it's still going to be 2018. And so we've got to ask ourselves this question: what do we need to do to be prepared for vital ministry in 2018? And so that's where Agape Spiritual Community comes in. It's Agape Spiritual Community is the name of this new church start that I and others have begun in Waltham. And I should say at the outset that if you feel fed by Church 2.0 as it is, then that is beautiful. That I would affirm that, door, how I would affirm that. It's not about making one way right and another way wrong. That everybody feels fed by worship and community life in different ways. So it's about honoring all those different ways. But what Dorhauer would say, and what I am trying to live out through this new expression of Church 3.0 in Agape Spiritual Community, is that some people are simply not fed by Church 2.0, including many young people, but people of all ages. And so Church 3.0 and Agape Spiritual Community, which is one expression of that, are experiments. They're experiments in what form of worship and music and community life resonate with a new generation of people. So it's not about making Church 2.0 wrong or Church 1.0 wrong. When Church 1.0 wasn't working 500-600 years ago, the Reformers, they simply sought out and experimented with new forms of worship and music and community life that would serve them in their new expressions of faith. And they didn't know 500 years ago what they were going to look like. But they were faithful to the process of going. And so that's what Church 3.0 is doing and what Agape is doing. We're experimenting with these new forms of worship and music and community life. But at the heart of everything we seek to do is our name, which is Agape, which is a Greek word that points to unconditional love. And where we seek to be contemplatives in action. Where we seek to have different events to allow people to experience and receive God's love. And then to go and to give that love away in different forms and expressions through service and peace and social justice. Whether it's through worship or dinner church or taste and see events or service experiences, it's all centered around that, allowing people to receive God's love, to remember that unconditional love that exists within them, and then to go and to be that love and make God's love and justice real in the world. And so, even though you might say Agape is new, it's just as old as the early church. It's just in a different form, in a different expression. That Church 3.0 and many expressions are, though they may look different than what has gone before, we simply have different wineskins, but the same wine. We're just seeking to be faithful to God's love and the good news of Jesus in a different way and a different form. Because really, it's not so much about the form that it takes, so much as about the passion and connecting to God's love, to that inner voice that exists within us, and making that love real in the world, no matter what form or expression we take. Amen. So friends, I invite us to join.